Hello, and thank you for tuning in to the Final Draft Right On podcast. I'm Pete D'Alessandro, your host and product manager here at Final Draft. This is the screenwriting podcast where we talk about all things filmmaking. It's award season, and today we have our New York correspondent, Michael C. Bryan, in conversation with the legendary screenwriter and 2016 Hall of Fame inductee, Paul Schrader, about his latest project, First Reformed. Here's Michael.
I loved how you were saying in that book about how they didn't want a Brit to direct that. They wanted an American to direct that. And why was that?
No. Originally, Schlesinger was going to do it.
Oh, really? John Schlesinger?
Yeah.
Really?
And then John got cold feet. He didn't think he could pull it off. And Rupert didn't want to do it with John because Rupert said, you know, I need somebody to protect my backside. And
why did he say that?
Because they're okay.
Well, Schlesinger, of course. That's right.
Character is hetero.
That's right.
And so...
although you're the king of ambiguity, so... Yeah.
So we had a sort of code on that one with Rupsy, because...
Rupsy.
I would always say, you know, Rupert, I just saw a little bit of the pink dress there. So, okay.
That's great. And he loved that, didn't he?
Yeah, he did. And he came out shortly after that and came out about 10 years too early. And it really hurt his career.
You know, that's very strange. It's funny I hear that, and I'm sort of amazed at that. I mean, you've always been very vocal about the fact that the sexuality of the gay community, which is hysterical to me because as a gay man, I feel that this impossible thing that I have to attain and be, whereas you say it was a liberating thing at the time when you were younger and all your critical writings and stuff, right?
Well, I mean, I brought over Nando Scarfiati, Bertolucci's production designer.
Oh, my God.
For Gigolo and Cat People. And Nando was extremely charismatic. Mm-hmm. And he created a community around him of aesthetes. And this was just in those years leading up to AIDS. Mm-hmm. And so it was...
Yeah, this was like 83. This report exploded about 82.
He came over in 78. And I just fell... sort of in love with that world.
Yeah.
And because I was going through a period where I was learning how to think visually. Uh-huh. Because I had come from a religious background where if you had ideas, you used words or song. You didn't use imagery. You didn't use pictures.
Well, now we're going to go down that whole route because you talked about how as a kid you never grew up with movies.
Yeah. So I didn't really realize that images could be ideas.
Right. Well, you know, I know who you're going to talk about. Now, you can go ahead and talk about it.
This right here, I'm holding this plastic bottle. This is an idea. Mm-hmm. I never thought that was an idea. I thought it was...
Charles, how do you pronounce his last name?
Eames.
Yes.
Yeah.
Now, that's fascinating. Because the cracking open of what he did in terms of that, in addition to, which is what I really, really love, is the idea that we're all connected. There's no separation. So you take that idea, and this is what you were saying before, I don't know if you still believe this now, but the combination of that we're all connected. See, the spirituality, when you talk about spirituality in your work, it's so profound. See, this is God saying to us that we're onto something. that whole thing you said that sort of opened everything up for you, the visual representation, the idea, the connection that we're all connected.
Yeah, I mean, it took me a while to figure out how to think visually. Mm-hmm. And the first two films I directed were more or less illustrative. I was just illustrating the story. But by the time I got
Really? You think that?
Yeah.
Oh, I disagree.
I mean, but
they're extraordinary to live in.
But, I mean, I don't think... I was just doing a visual representation of the script. I wasn't reimagining the script... visually.
Which do you think is the best example of you visually representing the script in a way that you're still happy with? Of the early stuff?
It was Gigolo. It was Scarfiotti. You know, he taught me how to do it.
That bar. I want to dive into that
bar.
Well,
if you look at Conformist, you know, he one of the things he pioneered in that film was using locations as other locations.
That's right.
You know, he would use a bank as a restaurant. He would use, like this. He was constantly reimagining space.
That's right.
And that's how he thought. And and once you got into his mindset, you started thinking that way too. Mm. And so that was the force.
I love that. That's so neat. And that's what informed when you were doing American Gigolo. That informed how much forethought was there? Because you talked a lot about it.
I put Nando in charge of everything visual. Mm-hmm. So he was in charge of wardrobe. Mm-hmm. He was in charge of props. Mm-hmm. He was in charge of locations. Mm-hmm. He was in charge of sets. Mm-hmm. And everybody reported to him. Mm-hmm. So I, in fact, handed a kind of co-directing to him. Mm-hmm. And so so I let him, you know, to just create the film visually. Mm-hmm. And by watching him do that, I learned how it's done.
See, that's amazing, because I'm wondering where the instinctual, because the prep for it was so huge. Because when you talk about Bressonian and Bresson, I was looking at all these things and thinking about this, the transcendence, the moving towards that. It's fascinating to me that this idea that you're always reaching for, I don't know if you still go for this, is where everything is, to the surprise of someone like myself who's fully engaged, we're now coming to this moment of this catharsis, this emotional thing that's happening. How much of that is conscious or unconscious now? Or do you even think about this still?
Well, I do, obviously. You do? First Reformed is full of it.
Exactly.
I mean, there's another reality running right alongside us.
Yeah, okay, good, yeah.
And sometimes it's so close that you can almost reach over and touch it. Mm. And there are different ways to access it. Mm-hmm. Different techniques and mindsets. And so what you're trying to do often in the arts is just give a little peek into that non-material world.
It's like the leaning in thing you talk about a lot, which I think is really beautiful. The space for that.
I mean, you know, everybody believes in a non-material world, but most people have a very hard time connecting with it.
Oh, absolutely. To think that the intangible is tangible, and Bresson, that's what he did so well. Against your better desires, he proved that to you. And that's what's amazing. It's that sort of textural sort of thing you sense.
Yeah. Well, when you start talking about transcendental style, which is sort of what we're talking about.
That's right.
You're talking about withholding devices.
Yes.
And how...
I really want to hear you talk about withholding, because in First Reform, you talk a lot about that, what that really means.
Well, movies are desperate for our attention.
Well, they're a little shoving in our faces.
Great. They grab us by the lapels and say, "Love me, love me. Here's some beautiful girls. Here's some fast cars. Here's some explosions. And here's music to tell you how to feel."
Exactly.
All the time.
Exactly. It's exhausting.
And so people get used to being passive.
That's right.
Because movies do everything for them.
Right.
Now, when you start withholding devices, you're starting to take away things that people have come to expect from movies.
That's like in the frame in First Reformed, when you have her walk in, right? And then you have him come in. And then when you hold that before they walk in, there's an amazing assurance in that. Yeah. That's so fun.
Well, the withholding devices are the major one is, of course, music.
Right.
People are so used to saying, what should I feel now? Where's the music?
Right.
Another is, of course, camera movement. Another is editing that tells you who's most important right now. If I just show you a two-shot of two people talking and I never cut, you have to start to figure out, am I most interested in the person who's talking or listening?
So just go ahead and talk about that gorgeous opening then in First Reform, because that's unreal. So when that happens and then it holds and then you cut in for that push into him when he does the Bresson sort of diary thing, right? It's an amazing thing. And what I love about that is you're saying, okay, so you're getting used to this. Guess what?
Yeah.
Wake up a little bit. Lean in. Get involved. I think that's just so
great.
Yeah, I mean,
one of the nice things about making a rule is you get to break it.
That's right. That's right.
And you have to break it because people forget you made it.
That's right.
So if you don't pan or tilt or move the camera, then also you do one odd camera move and people say, well, what was that? And then they're back locked in. I think the best way to describe this is the notion of the delayed cut.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a door there, and in a movie, you cut when the door opens and closes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Bresson, he was the first one I saw do this. He's on the door, the guy leaves, door closes. One, two, three, cut.
Is it pickpocket or priest you're talking about? Or something else? Both of them, because he does that a lot in both of those.
I'm escaped as well.
Yeah.
And now, your eye does not do that. Your eye does not linger on a door after someone walks out.
You're talking about perception. You're talking about the way things are perceived. Yeah.
Yeah. So your eye immediately finds something else to look at.
Yeah.
But now you're in a movie.
Yeah.
And there is nothing else to look at but that door.
Yeah.
And so what's happening here? Something is happening. It's not nothing. You can't say nothing's happening.
Yeah.
Because time is happening.
That's right. That's right.
And time is now acting upon the image. Because when you watch that image for 2 seconds, that's one thing.
Right.
But what if I hold it for 5 seconds? What if I hold it for 10 seconds? You know, the force of duration upon an image is one of those tools that changes our perception of the value of the image. And of course, it's also linked to meditation, because that's sort of what you do in meditation, too.
Well, yeah, I've been doing TM meditation for years, and it's funny to hear you and watch your films, because it's like this transcendent sort of thing. And, of course, that's the name of the critical work. But moving towards that, so in all these things you're talking about, these tools and what have you, is it still moving towards that moment, that release? Because I had that happen when I saw at 12... my parents took me to see a double bill. It was 1976. They took me to see Lenny, which came out in 74. But in 76, it was Taxi Driver and Lenny. And my mother made it through Lenny somehow. She was like, God, Valerie Perrin likes to show her booze lot. And then we made it through. My father took me. I was realizing when I was looking at your stuff, my father took me to all your early films. We went to them together. So I loved your story about hardcore in him. But when that moment came, when Travis walks in, and then remember, he holds up the hand, he shoots the 2 fingers off.
Yeah.
Something occurred to me there. It was shock, but it was this moment of absolute release for me, and it haunted me for years, that moment. I could never figure out why. Hmm. And when you created that, because the more I watch your work, and I've been watching it for years, and see that moment lean to all the different things that came in for that moment, the creation of the acceleration of this epiphany, this emotional release. I don't agree with anyone that doesn't say that your work isn't very funny and very emotional. It is for that, but you have to also engage and be active. So are you still in that place of the transcendent, the moment, creating and all these things we're talking about towards this moment, or is it more like if it comes, it comes?
Well, not every film is that, you know. First and foremost, I did a film called Dog Eat Dog, which was profane as heck and is a sort of Tarantino-esque exaggerations. So you're not always repeating the same thing. But in First Reformed, I had a chance to circle back to where I started.
Yes, you did.
And where I started was realizing that what we were studying in church and seminary, they were also doing in the movies. Mm-hmm. And I didn't think this was true. But all of a sudden I saw the Bergman films. And I was in college. And I said, my God, the same thing we're talking about, he's talking about, only he's making a movie.
Well, in reference to, like, what works of Bergman are you talking about?
Oh, Through a Glass Darkly.
Yeah, okay, good, yeah. Oh, that's such a good film.
And I realized that my this business of the movies, which were proscribed, forbidden by the church, in fact, they were doing the same thing. And then I, a couple of years later, when I saw Bresson, I realized that there was, in fact, a bridge between my sacred upbringing in the church and my profane present in Hollywood and UCLA. Mm-hmm. But it was not a bridge of content. It was a bridge of style. And that certain people all around the world were using the same style of devices to approach the ineffable and the holy.
Okay, so for you, to hear you talk about style, a man who's so beautifully, cerebrally, like a playground in your mind when I read your writing and hear you talk and all these things, how can the style and the content be merged in? So that's what we're talking about here, right? So it's those two things, because there's such a clear, decisive thought process when I look at the way things are set up in your film.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I have to admit it is a little bit of a fudge, because...
Yeah, right, exactly.
Here's the fudge, which is that theoretically, if it is style, not content,
right,
and that if a Zen garden is the same thing as a Chartres cathedral,
right,
then I should be able to make a film about a plumber which reaches transcendence. But somehow... easier when you make them about a man of the cloth.
That's right. Yeah. So
there's the fudge.
Yeah. And I can see what you're saying. So what is it now that you're interested in? Because it's funny, looking at First Reformed, and I listened to the audio commentary, so it was just so enjoyable to go there with you to those places. Where is now the understanding? Because the full circle of your work, to me, is very clear.
Yeah, and
I'll tell you what I wanted to call this podcast, and you'll enjoy this. I think we should call this... the name that I wanted to come up with, and I think you'll enjoy this. I'm going to see if I can find this here in my notes here. It's doing God's work with the devil's tools. I think that makes sense for a lot of your work.
There's an absolute symmetry about this film, First Reformed. And it goes back to, I may have said this on the commentary, a morning in March 1969.
No, you didn't talk about that. This is great.
Okay. I was a film critic for the Los Angeles Free Press, which mm-hmm. was a counterculture radical magazine.
And you were very smart how you worked that when I read about how you did that. It was very clever.
and there was a screening, a press screening for Pickpocket in the morning mm-hmm. at the Lemley Theater. Now, it's only 75 minutes long, film.
Yeah.
But in that 75 minutes, I realized two things.
Yeah.
First was this, what I just said now. There is a connection between the expression of the holy and motion pictures, and it's a connection of style.
Mm-hmm.
And the second thing I realized was that there could be a place for me in the motion picture business.
Mm-hmm.
I was a film critic. I had a very haughty idea of an acolyte of Pauline Kael. And basically, I thought film critics were better than filmmakers. We will tell you when you make a good film. And I was living with a group of filmmakers, film students, who were doing a biker film for Roger Corman. And I just thought this was so...
Yeah, I read it. It's a fantastic piece.
Yeah.
And it still holds up, and you're correct.
Yeah. Well, I thought this was so déclassé.
Yeah, you clearly.
I didn't know. But then I looked at this movie.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, I could do that.
Yeah.
He writes in his journal, he goes out, steals something, writes in his journal, goes out, talks to his neighbor, writes in his journal, please come and visit him. I could do that movie.
Yeah.
So 1 year after that, 2 years after that that moment in March 69,
mm-hmm.
I wrote the book, Transcendental Style.
Mm-hmm.
And 3 years after, I wrote Taxi Driver.
Mm-hmm.
Now, so at that moment, two seeds fell into my personal petri dish. And it's taken 50 years for them to grow and finally meet.
This is so great.
And I didn't quite realize that. But at the same time I was starting to write this script, I got swung back to that book.
Mm-hmm.
And I updated the book at the same time. And I realized that, you know, I was finally bringing these two vectors together, because in my mind they were separate vectors.
Mm-hmm.
The whole thing about spirituality and art and the whole thing about filmmaking, to me, the twain would never meet.
Yeah, but all your characters have always done this, and you talked about this, how I think it's Jacob, the wrestling at night, when you're wrestling with the devil, and it's actually the angel of God in the morning. That is the great transcendent, that is the big, that is why your films are so moving, I think, is because that is exactly where we find God, is in the fighting with devil, fighting with those things. And in the morning, we see that very thing that we are trying to run from is our salvation.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think I've only made one film in this style, the last one. The others were too contingent on psychological realism. And psychological realism will never get you to the quiet place, because somebody's doing it for you. When somebody, you know, it's like I was talking with Ethan Hawke,
mm-hmm.
and he was talking about Malcolm X, and he said that he was so disappointed. This is a terrific film by Spike Lee.
Yeah.
But when Malcolm has his conversion, he's on his knees and he's crying. And he said, that's the whole movie. And Spike does it in 30 seconds, and you don't feel a thing. And I said, why is that? And I said, well, you just told me why it is. They're doing it for you. You know, the oldest maxim in the entertainment, if they're crying on stage, they're not crying in the stalls. And if you let your performers cry and make psychologically real connections, it takes the viewer off the hook.
But also when you were talking about how Ethan near the end of the film then burst out into tears, and you said your instinct said that, and you realized...
Well, he didn't burst out into tears, his voice broke.
Yeah, well, yeah, and he cried. But you were saying that you trusted that, whereas the way it was written, he said, I can play it stoic.
Yeah.
But instead he decided he did it, and you both thought it played. So that's where instinct comes in.
Yeah.
But that's why, Brisson, when you're talking about that, when you're saying the cleanliness of you decide, you infer, you make the decision what's happening, I'm not going to tell you. And that's when you talked about that you know, divisiveness between you and Kale, where, you know, we're going to tell you, and then you say, wait a minute. I like the idea of they bring their thing. So it's that engagement, it's the activeness, it's what you call about the leaning in, you know, which I think is so fascinating about.
Yeah.
And you may not feel this, and sometimes I read some things, who knows if it's friggin' real.
Just so the viewer isn't confused, when I talk about leaning in, I'm not talking about the artist leaning in.
No, you're talking about the viewer leaning in.
Yeah, I'm talking about the artist leaning away.
Yeah. You know, the artist is going to a different state.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, and that's what I like, is with everything we're talking about, it's that precipice, it's that beautiful place of instinct, where it's like, I'm now going to take you to the point where I think that you might want to turn away, but I'm going to do this and go ahead and pull you back in. Now I want you to lean in. And that's fascinating to me. I mean, does that come to you via meditation? Are you a big meditator?
I have. I'm not a David Lynch status.
Yeah, well, I did his TM meditation one time. Yeah, well, I went there and they charged me $3,000 for a meditation. And I was like, I think I'll call my friend Sally, who lives in the Bronx.
how many hours is that?
It was 15 hours, and they give you your own little mantra. And then I realized that I didn't need that mantra for TM.
Wow.
Yeah.
David's really onto something there.
He's really onto something. He's got his screenwriting school, and he's got the TM school. So have you, where did you learn meditation? Just around?
Yeah. You know, from the tapes, you know.
Yeah.
But I've got a great David Lynch story.
Oh, go for it.
I was at AFI, the first year that the AFI was established.
Mm-hmm, famous.
Terry Malick, David Lynch, Tom Rickman, Stanton Kaye. And David had done a racer head, and he had written Blue Velvet.
Mm-hmm.
And he had gotten Dino interested, but Dino wanted it rewritten. Dino couldn't understand it. And
so, De Laurentiis, for people that don't know who you're doing. Yeah.
So Dino gave David a list of writers that would be acceptable to him.
He said this to David Lynch.
Yeah.
To rewrite Blue Velvet.
Yeah.
Okay, this is great.
And he looked at the list and said, you were the only one I knew on the list.
Yeah.
And I said, well, let me read the script. I read the script. I called him up. I said, I'm not going to rewrite this. I think it's one of the most brilliant, brilliant things I've ever read. It should not be. And he said, well, Dino won't make it unless someone rewrites it, and he wants you to rewrite it. I said, okay, let's set up a lunch. We'll go to Mommy's Home. We'll get the table right next to Orson's, you know, and you and Dino and I and his son or daughter, and we'll go through it.
Mm-hmm.
So I had the script, I had a whole bunch of notes, and I started going through the script at lunch.
Mm-hmm.
And about halfway through the script, I finally just took my script and threw it down and said, I'm not going to do this. The script is brilliant. I refuse to rewrite it. I'm sorry. I will pay for lunch. I'm sorry. I even agreed to have this lunch. No one should rewrite this script. And so that was sort of we finished up the lunch. And a couple of days later, I ran into David, and I said, you know, well, how did that work out with Dino? He said, oh, he likes the script now.
That was very deftly played on your part.
Yeah, well, nice, and of course, we had planned the whole thing.
Yeah, of course you had. Yeah. Oh, that's fantastic. Why did he ask you to rewrite it? What of yours did he, like, wax poetically?
Well, I was...
I mean, it's not a far reach, to be honest with you, that you would understand that world.
But still. But I had you know, made a number of big sales. So I was the hot young writer.
So that was like 85, 84. When was Blue Velvet?
No, this is 79. 79.
Well, but Blue Velvet was like 80-something, right?
I was at AFI.
That's right.
In 79, 80.
That's right. And that was before, okay, that was when you were selling everything and writing everything. That's very known.
Yeah. That's when I was on those lists, yeah.
What's a work that you still, to this day, would like something to happen with it? Is there anything that you've written that is in the drawer and you're thinking to yourself, this is quite good?
Well, I have a script I wrote about 15 years ago, James Ellroy book, that...
I love James Ellroy. Oh, my God.
We're trying to get this one made. It was as funny as I wrote it 15 years ago, and they didn't like it. And they threw it, and they paid me off. And then I heard that they were trying to set it up. They couldn't get it set up. Well, it turned out that they had hired another writer, done another script, and this script nobody wanted to make. Mm-hmm. And I said to my agent... You know, I wrote a version of that script. And he called up the producer and said, "Do you ever read Schrader's script?" He said, "Paul Schrader wrote a script of this book."
Jesus.
He said, "Yes, it was the first one." And I had to go to my archive in Austin, you know, the Ransom Center, and get a copy of it and send it. And I sent it to the producer. He said, "This script is terrific. Let's make this one." So we're trying to put it together.
Oh, that's great. And it's still, and you still like it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought it was, that was for Turner.
Uh-huh.
And they were just sort of in the process of getting out of that.
Mm-hmm.
So it was ill-timed.
Yeah. When you say Turner, who are you referring to?
TNT?
That's what I thought. Okay, TNT, right. Can you say what the book is?
It's called Clandestine.
Oh, that's
a... It leads up to L.A. Confidential.
Mm-hmm.
The Dudley Smith character in L.A. Confidential, played by James Cromwell, is the main character in this book.
Mm-hmm. You know what's great about what you talked about, too, and I got to say, this is so wonderful, this space thing, that spaciousness, the thing that you're like, we need a little bit of spaciousness for things to actually occur. And this idea that we're crammed so full of information to feel, to think, to react in a way. This open spaciousness, it's an amazing open thing in First Reformed. And I found this in a lot of, you may not even have been conscious of this, that this unconscious stuff was occurring, but in your early stuff, this also happens quite a bit.
Well, I started doing that Ozu thing, which is Ozu called the pillow shots, where he just does these tableaus, still lifes, you know, so you'll have a whole series of emotional scenes, and then he'll have a series of still lifes, and Western music will play, and then he'll go back in. And it's his way of stopping you and starting you and, you know, controlling your sense of time.
Right.
So as early as Gigolo, I started doing those shots.
Right. I'm not really thinking it influenced much of Mishima.
Not so much.
Not so much in Mishima.
No.
That is such, it's just, are you still as proud of that as you used to speak about it as?
It is the damnedest thing. You know, it's been a long time now, but there's nothing like it. I don't suppose there ever will be.
I don't think so either.
Yeah.
It's extraordinary. I've seen it on the big screen. They had it at the American Museum Moving Image. I live in Queens. And they played it in the museum, and it was absolutely extraordinary on the big screen.
Yeah.
It works perfectly.
They've done a 4K clock. On it now. Yeah.
Really? Oh, that's nice.
In Criterion, yeah.
Yeah. All right, did you do the commentary for it?
Yeah.
So what do you remember best about it? What's your favorite thing about that? Because, you know, I've been living all your work for years, but that thing really struck me when I first saw it.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's never been shown in Japan.
Yeah, still. I was going to ask you, still.
Yeah, because...
Really?
And, you know, the story of its financing, which...
It's famous, yeah.
All that stuff. So it's a weird situation where you're there, you're making a movie that isn't going to be shown.
Yeah.
And no one is claiming they paid for it. And
that's so unlike the entertainment industry.
And so you're sort of saying, I can do anything I want.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden the weight of freedom settles on your shoulders. You say, wow, the fact that I can do anything I want is very onerous. Because usually you walk around and say, well, we had to do that. We had to sell some tickets. We had to make some compromises.
But wasn't that freeing for you? Because you've never been a company man. You've always wanted to do your own thing anyway.
I didn't have the feeling on that. I remember, you know, usually when you make a film, you sort of figure that should you die, something it'll get finished somehow.
Uh-huh.
And I remember
I love that thinking. That's fantastic. I love that's the default thinking. I'm going to say that now at parties.
And I remember thinking, if I should die,
yeah,
I don't think they'll know how to finish this film.
No, they couldn't, because it was. You said this in the book, and this is true, that they said during the filming that if you don't do this, we're not going to know what the frig to do with this movie. Is that about right?
Yeah.
Well, there's an intuitive thing in that film. It's such a beautiful film, and it holds together so lovely. I mean, it all makes perfect sense, the symmetry of it. How much of that is conscious to you in life as an artist? I mean, the symmetry. What? Well, you know, when you... I get the sense in looking at your work that you're always...
That's a highly crafted puzzle box of a film.
That's correct. It is.
And it has four thematic chapters.
Yep.
And three different styles. And so there's a kind of crosshatch of this. And I said to Philip Glass,
I can't even with that score.
I said to him, I'm making a lot of little boats. And there's nothing that holds all these little boats together. You got to make the river.
Yeah, I love that. I think that's fantastic.
And we overscored it. Usually movies are underscored, but we overscored that.
Well, it's an extraordinary score.
Yeah.
And that last moment, moment when everything comes together. So that's the transcendent stuff you're talking about.
Yeah, where
that's
he becomes one of his own characters.
That's correct. And where everything melds in the very last images. It's so beautiful. That last image of the sun. Is that right?
Yeah.
It's the sun, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's so extraordinary. Yeah. So what is pulling at you nowadays that you want to explore next? I mean, it's always about, because you're very much a man who looks forward, even though you're, your tombstone, by the way, which I remember you said this one time, you're like, this is the worst thing. If you didn't put on your tombstone, I achieved something, right? I think that's wonderful. Like Woody Allen once said, there's nothing worse than an artist who has something to say and doesn't know how to say it or a method with which to say it. It's a torturous thing.
Yeah, well, there's the Peckinpah film, Ride the High Country.
Mm-hmm.
The Joel McRae character named Steve Judd.
I know what you're going to say. Go ahead. I love this.
And, you know, and Randy Scott says to him, what do you want, Steve? He says, I just want to enter my house justified.
I love that.
And that's a quote from Sam's father, who was a preacher.
Yep.
And
he was a Supreme Court guy. Yeah. A Supreme Court guy too, wasn't he? Yeah.
And that was the gratification of First Reformed. You can say, well, I can enter my house justified. But I have another film that I'm trying to get going with both Ethan and Willem.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm trying to do this Elroy thing. And I've been a little slow because. You know, this whole year has been sort of consumed by First Reform.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're now in the 15th or 16th month of this thing. And, you know, usually a film is a week or two, three, particularly an independent film, and then it's gone.
Mm-hmm.
And we've got another month or so to go.
So why is that? Is the mechanics of everything, or do you think it's something else?
No, we first showed it at Venice a year ago, September.
Mm-hmm.
And then we sold it out of Toronto.
Mm-hmm.
And then we kept screening it and released it in May.
Mm-hmm.
And now we're into award season.
But do you know why, though, this is happening with the work? I have a suspicion, but as an artist, can you step away and say?
A24 was quite smart about the film.
They're very smart in general.
Yeah, they realized that this particular film had a shelf life.
Mm-hmm.
And that if they just took their time,
mm-hmm.
the movie seemed to stay in people's minds.
You know why, don't you, with that ending?
Yeah.
Yeah. Ambiguity has gotten out of style, and that's a shame.
Yeah.
Ambiguity is a gorgeous thing. And I'm not going to say for people that haven't seen it. I mean, I want to, but whatever. Yeah.
Yeah. And so they could have released it a year ago.
Yep.
In 2017.
Mm-hmm.
But they just decided, you know, that this one is a very, very slow rollout. And what they wanted to know and what they were doing, they would ask people at various festivals what they heard about the film.
Mm-hmm.
Then they would show the film at the festival. Then they would ask them again, was it what you expected? And they kept getting a bump, because normally you hear about a film, you see it, and you say, it's not all that, you know? But people said, well, it's everything I heard, you know? And that's when they realized that they should play it slow.
How did it feel to you to know that? How does it feel to you to know that people, I mean, seriously, Paul, people are seeing this and they're deeply moved and affected by it. And it's getting to the very, it's like that acorn idea that we are God, God is in us, God is love, all that sort of. I looked at that, really looked at that. I read what that's about. It's such a beautiful central image in addition to, okay, so this is what fascinates me. You got you as a writer with the diary, which connects back to Bresson's and Bressonian all of the work. Then you got the acorn, which is in there. Then you got, of course, the whiskey and the alcohol, the lubrication from earlier, and the echoes with Taxi Driver, all that sort of stuff, right? And you've got this all framed in almost an impressionistic painting. Every single time you shoot it, it looks like that. So that's having an accumulative effect on people and saying the sum of their lives. I mean, how does that feel to know
and
that
then that's... I threw in the barbed wire from Wise Blood.
Yes, exactly. Well, that and that book. That's a very good book. I wonder if a lot of people know that though. Yeah.
Hazel Moats.
Yeah, yeah. What a good name. That's such a good name. Is that a good name?
Yeah.
Oh, you can dig your teeth into that one. Yeah, it's so nice. But seriously, like, how do you feel knowing that this work, literally? I mean, I got to be honest with you. This work affects a lot of people.
Yeah, it does, and I get that. I get a lot of. Unsolicited email, you know.
It's very moving.
Yeah, like one day I got an email from Sharon Stone, who I don't know. Mm-hmm. Got one from Joyce Carol Oates, who I don't know. Mm-hmm. And one from Sherry Lansing, who I did know.
What did Joyce Carol Oates say, if I can ask?
You want to read it?
Joyce Carol Oates, absolutely. And if she's someone like me who's been reading your critical essays and your stuff for years, we're deeply moved by that stuff. Oh, I mean, I get to read this. Oh, my gosh. Paul's going to read it out loud. First Reformed is a subdued, neutral, surrounded title for a film by Paul Schrader as a sturdily beautiful and visionary as a film by Ingmar Bergman. Well, there you go. Ethan Hawke, astonishing. Last half hour, almost unbearably suspenseful. I couldn't agree more. And yet ending entirely unexpected. Audience sat transfixed. And this is a woman who... has written the kind of work that she knows what she's talking about. My favorite here is what she said. So last half hour, I felt this too. It was almost, I almost couldn't, I saw it the first time at the Angelica. Last half hour, almost unbearably suspenseful and yet ending entirely unexpected. And the way in which you shot that, and I loved what you said in the audio commentary. Both are happy endings.
Yeah.
I thought, you clever man. That's exactly right. They're both happy endings. And I also thought, maybe that's the bridge. Maybe this is the moment before. You know, is this really what's happening? Is this not? But it's that ambiguity. It's that mixture of otherness. It's the thing that Bresson was talking about, making the intangible tangible. I mean, this is the quality. How do you feel about knowing that this is what you're giving people in life? You're giving meaning to the things they can't find meaning to. I don't mean to, like, put a big thing on your shoulders, but you know what I mean, right?
Yeah, I mean, on one hand, that's gratifying, but if you've lived your life so that you could have an amount of self-respect. So I'm very glad critics like this movie, but if they didn't, it still would be a good movie.
I'm talking about the critics.
No, I'm saying critics, audiences, whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, even if the audience didn't like it, it would be a good movie.
Well, yeah, because you know you made something that really means something.
Yeah, that's right. And I'm now sort of on the award circuit. I was having a drink with Pavel Pavlovsky, who did Cold War. Mm. He said, it's amazing, this process we're in now, because they take you out day after day. You get emails day after day, and you start caring about something you really don't care about, because you can't be in this treadmill of...
But you've never been that kind of man, though, have you?
No, but I'm saying, it's just like Pavel, I'm saying... I'm now, you know, I get these updates, and all of a sudden, why should I be so concerned with the Austin film critics thinking about my movie?
But are you really concerned, though, about it?
Well,
or does it feed into something that didn't really exist before, that this new mechanism...
Well, it gets under your skin, because it happens to be the life you're leading right now.
Right.
Because A24 is here.
Yeah, but you know what's funny? I mean, maybe it's because you've experienced and seen so much and created all these things, but you have to know, with the people that know that we're speaking today, there was nothing but deep, deep appreciation and an understanding. You awakened something. You awakened something in people. And I don't know if you hear this enough, but you should know that you awakened something very deep in someone. And it's that transcendent thing in themselves, which you do, and it's a real thing. So I understand all this other, you've seen and done things most of us will never see and do, but the work that you're doing, and this work particularly, for those of us who know your work, it is taking our understanding of what spirituality means to a whole different place.
Yeah, well, it's like, you know, the first Ozu I saw was his last film, Autumn Afternoon. And I was gobsmacked.
Yeah.
I just didn't realize that a motion picture could move in that way and affect you in that way.
That's right.
And that just...
I mean, look, it's another form of a church.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what's so funny, because you say you grew up when everyone had theological discussions around the dinner table, right? So we go in to see these, and it's like being inside of a church, frankly. I always used to joke as a child, because I had a very weird childhood, and my church was the movies. That's where I went to find answers, because I wasn't getting answers at home. That was never my childhood. So while I saw movies, I saw your movies. So I should tell you where I was going.
Yeah.
I mean, do you see a scope of your life at this point in life? You know what I mean?
Well, like I say, I've said before, I mean, I hope this isn't the last film, but if it is...
No, by scope, I mean, like, what's coming next, what's showing up next.
I'm not sure.
You said the Elroy thing, but you said before, I mean, I don't like to read a lot before I meet somebody, that you'd be happy if this is your last film, but it doesn't feel like it to me.
What I said was, I hope it's not.
Okay, good.
But if it is,
good.
It's a good last film.
Well, of course it is. Yeah, look what it's doing.
You know, I mean... You know, so many times you look at a director and the last films are sort of an embarrassment because you can't plan your career the way a musician can plan a rock show. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't know what the encore is. You don't know what the final song is going to be. And sometimes, I felt this particularly 4 or 5 years ago when I had a terrible situation where a film was taken away from me and I disowned it. And I thought
that Nick Cage thing?
With the Dying of the Light, which I then re-edited to another film. And I remember just thinking, this is it. My career is going to be over, and I'm going to end it with this embarrassment. And I think that, more than anything else, kept driving me to, got in touch with Nick Cage and said, we can't let it in. I can't let it end this way.
Right.
And then we did another film, and that led to this one.
Well, it's always the thing you talked about, the redemption, pride, all those things, the movement towards that. Do you feel like there's not a need for you in your life for that, and that this is simply an examination of those themes? Like in other words, like, here's the thing. You've been questioning these things for a long time, and First Reformed is full circle. It's in many ways, in terms of thematic, in terms of visual, in terms of emotional. So the questioning now at this point in your life, you've thought very deeply about these things. You're not a man who hasn't inquired deeply in print in your own life. Like this next part is like, this is what I'd like to know now. Like, what would you like to know now? Can I think about these things?
Yeah, I wrote a script that I had to put away because it was so personal. I wrote a script about the relationship of my brother and myself.
Right?
Yeah. And it just wasn't good enough. But I think that's the...
Why wasn't it good enough?
I'm not sure.
Oh, okay.
I'm not sure if I knew I would rewrite it.
I read those diaries that were released.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If I knew I would rewrite it right now.
What do you think's missing? Like, if you were to say, is it possible because it's too personal? Because you always talk about how much you want to make it personal, but your stuff is always friggin' personal. Everything you make is personal.
Yeah, it was part Terry Malick, part Citizen Kane, and I couldn't quite get the two pieces to fit.
I love the Terry Malick and Citizen Kane. So a little bit of Orson Welles, a little bit of... Like when you say Terry Malick, how so?
Tree of Life, the imagistic exploration of the past.
Yeah, so from Days of Heaven, True Love Life, that sort of thing.
Yeah, but so on one hand, it was a man investigating his brother's life after the brother died. So that's Citizen Kane.
That's, okay, got it.
And then the other thing is all these memories coming up, and that's Tree of Life.
Got it.
And I was trying to combine those two, and I may go back, because it's not such a bad idea. But
not such a bad idea?
Yeah,
it's a great idea. I love the self-effacing, but it's a great idea.
Yeah.
So is it more like the stylistic visual representation of this? It sounds like a slightly more sort of unconscious sort of fluidity to it, that maybe some of your stuff is a little more controlled.
It's more...
What about Misha? Because you wrote Mishima with him, didn't you?
Yeah.
That's right, yeah. So that had a very surreal, yet bookended, you know what I mean? It had a very clear style to it. Is there something in there, maybe?
No, but I mean what happened, he was my older brother.
That's right.
And then I became the older brother.
That's right.
And then I stepped out of on my way over.
What do you mean by that?
He had stuff I wanted and that I had to take from him, and the first thing was Japan. And I took it. And he never forgave me.
And you never got that from him?
What?
Forgiveness.
No. No. No.
Have you forgiven yourself for that?
No, because I did it. I knew what I was doing, and I probably would do it again. You know, I mean, it's interesting. I used to think in terms of relationships as being very Freudian, father, son, like that.
Mm-hmm.
And now I've come to realize that they're much more like Darwin, and that the most important relationships are siblings, because those are the people that you have to survive. You know, you don't have to kill your father, but you do have to kill your siblings.
Mm-hmm. And that, so why the siblings are the most important? Is that because of...
Because they're, it's because that's how evolution works, you know? I mean, that's how a pack works.
That's why you have to, you have to get the script right, because this is what's hanging over you.
And that's why second children.
Yes.
70, there's a big book about this, 70% of the creative people, really creative people, are second child. Because the first child has a lock on the position. The second one has to create a new position.
What about the third one?
The same, and the third as well, yeah.
This is fascinating to hear this, because this is actually my sister and I. Because my sister is a PhD, she's very creative, but she also doesn't remember her childhood. And I am the writer, and I remember everything from my childhood.
Yeah, well, the name of the book came out about 15, 20 years ago. It's called Born to Rebel by Frank Soloway, who had also written a big book on Freud.
You must have ghostwritten that.
and he felt this was Freud's blind spot. And he... did biographies of 40,000 creative people,
mm-hmm.
and then started breaking it all down in the patterns.
That's great.
Yeah, so it's a terrific
book. Now, I don't know much about, is Leonard still with us or not?
No, he's been dead about 10 years.
Okay. And it just is still hanging over there, clearly.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, I certainly couldn't write this while he was alive.
Right, right.
Maybe I can't even write it, after.
I think you're right there. I think this is like probably the thing that's going to be the great thing that will maybe release some of this stuff. I always find that's the best thing. Even though you have been open about not making stuff too personal, that's where you feel you misstepped. I don't agree with that. I think that's when your best work comes out.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure, because I made one film that was sort of about my father and one film that was sort of about my mother, and they're... They both failed in my estimation.
They didn't fail. I have heard you say this a million times, and I'm not going to sit across from your table and agree with you on that. They didn't fail. Which do you think was the greater achievement? I know exactly what you're talking about, but what do you
well,
think?
Well, I mean, I, you know...
Light of Day, we know the casting issues, and Hardcore, we know the reasons. Okay.
Well, yeah, Light of Day was ostensibly about my mother's death, and yes. and I cast myself as a female rocker, but I just didn't get it right. I didn't get it right. And casting aside, I still didn't get it right.
Have you seen it recently?
No.
You won't see it, will you?
I know.
Yeah, you refuse, don't you?
No.
Yeah, I know. You're very open about that. Have you seen Hardcore recently?
No.
Oh, that's just, you need to see that.
Well,
it's very funny.
Actually, I did about a year and a half ago. I did an audio commentary for it. First time I'd seen it since it came out.
Right. And?
And I sat there for 2 hours and slagged the motherfucker.
Why did you do that?
I said, oh, my God.
What Why? It's so funny.
Oh, my God, he's going to move the camera. Hold on.
Okay, so when Boyle goes into the room to watch the sex act, and he's all excited, right? And then you yell cut, and his face falls. That's hysterical. The stuff in that movie, it holds up. I know you didn't like the ending. Everything else is great.
Yeah. The...
See, it's that mischievous thing. I wish people could see you when you cracked up like that, because that mischievous thing, that's what's in the movie.
Yeah.
You've got to see the good parts of it, do you?
But for me, like, autofocus is more fun.
Oh, autofocus, please stop. I can't even with that movie. I have seen that so many times. That's a great thing. I'm going to do this weird thing. How much longer do we have? Oh, we're done. Okay, so is there anything that you've never said? Because you've been talked to, talked at, and hopefully I hope you feel this was talking with, that you've just never, like, I mean, look, this is a beautiful moment in yeah. everything.
If I've never said it, how would I know I've never said it?
Spoken like a true TM guy. All right, so.
Yeah, like Don Simpson once said to me, you know, how do you know you've gone too far unless you've gone too far?
Yeah, that's exactly
and
right.
And then he died of a cocaine overdose.
And this was the 80s probably, right?
Thanks again to Michael C. Bryan and Paul Schrader. Thank you to our audience for listening. On our next episode of Right On, we have a special two-part interview with director Mimi Leader and cinematographer Michael Grady from On the Basis of Sex. A special thank you to everyone who has subscribed and left us a review. You can stay in the know by following us on Facebook or find us on Twitter as @FinalDraftInc. And Instagram as @FinalDraftScreenwriting. Until then, right on.